decade. At my age, I'm counting very carefully. Let's see, I think I spotted it here. And this is, in fact, a slide taken in the sitting room of Whitaker's Lee's house in New York. Most people now have heard the fascinating life of the artist Fred Eversley. He lives between New York and Los Angeles. And I'm not going to repeat it for that reason again today. The facts are on the walls upstairs of the exhibition. But suffice it to say it for now, Fred's life is so fascinating because he was born a scientific prodigy and graduated from Carnegie Institute, today Carnegie Mellon, with a degree in electric engineering, and was the youngest engineer employed on the Apollo and Mercury missions, and the only African American engineer, of course. And he did that out in California between 63 and 66. He was employed by Wiley Lab, which was engaged by NASA to do the instrumentation. And Fred was really the chief engineer of the instrumentation. And after he said, after three nonstop years of daily work of racing to beat the Russians to the moon, he decided to follow his profession and become an artist. So 67 is also his 50th anniversary as an artist. And so his personal anniversary, 57, coincided perfectly with the colleges building on the legacy of the 67th anniversary of African-American students in residence here. And last week, the three students were back on campus, and Fred met them, and there was really a magical moment, as we're used to having here in Muskerella. Exactly as we expect. Today I'm going to talk about the artistic background to Fred's works, why they look the way they do, in addition to his own unique formation as a scientist first. Everyone likes to see behind the scenes, so I'm going to show you some snapshots I took while we were installing the show upstairs. And this was August 24th, and probably everyone has already forgotten there was a heat wave, but I haven't. And I came back from my and Aaron, our normal summer fence mending networking with our contacts in museums in France and Italy. And I went to that personally met, accompanied by the indefatigable Michelle Spike, who had just broken her foot. All the careers with Ralph Botticelli's and also prior shows. Leonardo, I came back in mid-July, just in time for this heat. And in that time, I curated these two shows and wrote the catalog on this one. So it's now official that Aaron is totally spoiled by the production he gets out of it. And there is a lot of unwrapping to do of the works. It came soft-wrapped, we call them, soft-packed. And one thing our couriers always comment on is that instead of sitting remotely in his grand office, as they imagine, our director comes and is hands-on in all aspects and sees them and dines with them, and that's an important factor in our success in obtaining these loans. They tell each other when they come, they say, "Oh, we heard how nice you are in Williamsburg as we sure we tried to be. So this is how far we have gotten at the end of the first day, setting things out. And next day we had to do the last room, especially. And there are these arcs hanging on the wall, and they were harrowing to hang up. Because, I don't know, with scientists, artists, devil may care approach, Fred has on the back of these delicate seeming objects. At any rate, a single hope that they're hanging on a nail not made to fit in it. So you may notice the signs around, you may notice that the guards are very zealous about getting near the objects. Similarly, the round lenses and mirrors that are in the show, they are not anchored to those blocks. They sit on between runners. And, you know, if touched, we would be chasing it. So when I was watching them play this, as a Renaissance man, this invention by Raphael, engraved by Mark Antonio Raimondi, was going through my mind. But then I started out and I thought back to this great piece of 1918. This single sculpture is the ancestor of all minimalist art. Fred became an artist in the 60s, which is the heyday, the advent, and therefore heyday also of minimalist art. And many, many artists involved, and there are many artists who, like Fred Eversley, used geometry, basic geometric forms. Some of them use simple materials, as he does. Often there is an interest in industrial mechanisms. But as I showed you some of the leading figures in the movement, I will also point out where Fred Eversley took a different route and actually combined different things. It is a modular. You see the endless column here of Bertuzzi. There are these truncated pyramids, and they repeat. And so you can't remove one. They have to be part of that succession. And that is typical of the idea of minimalism, which generated more dreams of theory about itself than reflection of the works themselves, I have to say. The principal founder of the movement is Carl André. And I suspect that he destroyed the first version of this in 1959, but then when he was famous, he could do whatever he wanted in 1970, he remade it. I suspect he destroyed the original version when someone pointed out, I see nothing here but Brancusi's endless color. You know, they do say there's nothing new under the sun. In the early part of the 20th century, most of the ideas that occupied artists for the rest of the 20th century worked out in decades. It's the way it is. And it's not so different from the 19th century either. André goes on, and to avoid being confused with Bertuzzi again, he makes these simple grid patterns, and he had a saying about it. He says, matter matters. And that is so catchy, you cannot read an article, as I have said in the last 2 weeks, you cannot read an article about minimalism without that catchy quotation. But what it means to me, a certified dyed-in-the-wool Platonist, is it means this is exalting matter over the spirit. And they wouldn't deny that. That they want to get down to brass tacks in their works. Donald John was an important figure in this. This is a typical work of his. I do not know if it is a photograph or in this work uniquely, he varies between tones of green and green and blue. At that time, blue and green, beginning in the late 50s, were a very, very current, I hate to say popular, because it's just amongst those who admire Miles Davis, current concept in, you know, blue, green, it's a jazz motif, and Ellsworth Kelly's early minimalist works use them too. You see all that writing? I wanted you to suffer through a little bit too. This is the prose style of writing minimalism. And then you see his simple factory-made forms were seen as radically depersonalized, and that was a virtue. And to remove himself, to not have any part or spiritual content in his work is not actually the passion of Fred Eversley. It is the reason he's not mentioned in every book about minimalism. And those who think that the West Coast form of it, which is called Light Space, which he was amongst the earliest practitioners, those who see it as identical to minimalism, well, they don't mention him. But we will fix that. He was friends with this artist, John McCracken, and they're all living in Venice Beach, California. You know, in the neighborhood was this gravelly-voiced, very well-named Jim Morrison, and a very popular high school girl from Texas named Janis Joplin. People like that went to this neighborhood as artists because it was very run down at the time. And they had built, when constructed, they built these kind of houses in the early 60s. They were abandoned. And this, I show this picture of him uniquely because he lived across the street from Fred. And Fred told me during his visit last week that their works were so heavy that they couldn't turn them over by themselves. So they'd call each other and go over and help their friend turn their work when it was time to lacquer the other side of it, and so forth. And he, McCracken, came up with this idea of the plank. And it had a symbolic meaning for him, usually. It is a bridge to things. And I'm showing you how they are installed, because you need to know we did an art show here. I'm going to show you past installations of Fred Eversley's. This is how you show minimalist art, since the point is the specific object. I'm quoting Carl Manfred. What have you got here? See, it's a cube or a rectangle. It's a specific object, and that is be respected in all its specificity. It's actually easy to pick this up. So here are these. And this is not meant to be witty. McCracken believed in UFOs and time travel. I like to compare his works to items possibly left behind by space traveling aliens. Well, because the works of the minimalist artists, and that includes certain opaque works by Fred Eversley, because they are separate from, they don't seem organic. The white opaque one seems like polished marble. That's polyester rosin, highly polished by iron. And the black one seems to be whatever precious stone. It's black and looks like that. And they do have this otherworldly quality, and lots of people have felt, looking at Fred's works, that there was a space age quality to it, which is, of course, not so surprising, since he worked on space ships. Now, out on the West Coast, I'm not going to mention many artists that I could, but it would just be repeating the same point, but there is this chap, John McLaughlin. And this is an exhibition of his at the LA County Museum in 2016. And they say, he must be the most important post-war artist you don't No. And that he's not Rome. It's in L.A. These are his works. And I'm still quoting that article in the L.A. Times about the light space movement, which is where Fred Eversley begins. They commissioned these chairs from an artist, the museum did, to put in front, based on, I read incredulously, the principles of the late McLaughlin. And that is amazing to me. But this is the only time, place, and style in which it is imaginable to do that, because after the 1950s, with the emotional angst and fury thrown out on the canvases and the artist's hands, it's called gestural art, the abstract expressionism of the 1950s, Pollock and Franz Klein, the greatest, Willem de Kooning also, there was a reaction against it. Some people went into parodying the society, and that's called pop art, and the minimalists went back to the clarity of geometry, and they're happy that their works don't impose on us the emotions of the artist. It's not really a lasting point of view about art. I mean, we rather like it when the artist seems to share his innermost concerns with us. But at this time, no, absolutely not. And another thing about the, let's say the credo behind minimalism was, they wanted it, the ideal would be, I could describe to Aaron Groft the painting exactly how it consisted of, what the measurements were, because it's all measured, and he could go home and make one. Mm-hmm. And there was an artist named Saul Alit, who did this with geometric lines, and if you bought a work by Saul, he handed it to you in an envelope. Inside was a single piece of paper, say, take a wall of a dimension, 3 feet from one side and 4 feet up, draw a line at a certain angle, and so forth. And that's the work of Saul Witt. And another artist was at that time. We had a major example by him staring at us from the back wall behind the entrance desk. So please, everyone turn around and look at that picture. That is a red square with converging from the corners, green lines on top of red. And it causes an illusion, the flare that comes out of the corner of the square, not that our eyes cannot process the lines get so close together. So, and this gave us too, could hand to us a description of what his measurements were and how to make that. Only in his case, we couldn't, because devilishly difficult to make. Incredibly, never had an imitator. He still is an octogenarian. I know him well. No one could ever imitate him. So as we look at McLaughlin, sophisticated Muscarelli audiences like ours say, similarly to the equivalent of Prophet Marcuse, why I see nothing here but the manner of Mondrian. And yes, in fact, and here it is, pre-war, and Mondrian did these things. And Mondrian was trying to make interesting compositions. Minimalism stops at just too emotional. Interesting composition. And really, don't bleed all over the picture, please. But the concept that this is enough for a picture is Mondrian's discovery. And Mondrian affected everyone, and this chap introduces him to the West Coast. The East Coast, it's because Mondrian came to New York during World War II, and he had a studio there. And very, very curiously, because now we've gotten to specialize here at the Muscarelli, and astonishing coincidences. Here's another one. As I was visiting here the first time, I'd come to visit Aaron Groft and join the board years before I transferred here. through some sleight of hand, their parents. Michelle and I found ourselves here. But in those early visiting years, there in the stairwell was a work of painted rectangles, squares, colored, and it's clearly a work of this time and place. Said, James Guy, what is that? So familiar, and I realized I took studio art from him in college. And why I'm telling you that story is, it was well worth taking the course with him, because he had met Mondrian, had gone to Mondrian's studio in New York, and told me what it was like, and that he was a very nice man, Mondrian. And he stood there with an easel there in front of him, waiting for visitors, about visitors. He had the tape, and when people came in, really just to be congenial, he would say, "Do you mind moving the tape one quarter inch to the right?" Probably as soon as the chap left, he would be back. And here you have, you see, you're only 3 degrees removed from home here. This is how I try to drill into my students. History is not a thing that's dead and gone. We are in it. And we might as well enjoy it. Well, Fred, from the example of McLaughlin, would have learned, and here's where the chairs come in, they have a good excuse. They put them there in order to emphasize and direct the viewers into thinking about the gaps between the motifs and not the motifs. Mondrian's pictures are about where he puts the red and so forth. This chap, who won a Bronze Star in World War II for service in the Pacific and knew a lot of Japanese, was influenced by Japanese Zen art, and he cares about the intervals between things. And that is something different from the Donald Judd's, where it's not the interval between those blocks, they are the boxes. It is the motif and the 144 aluminum plates. It's not the crack between them. It's the interval. So you see we go where he wants already to go, but McLaughlin actually invites us to look at the void. So Fred also received early on commissions to do important public works. The one at right, which is in Piazza Repubblica, della Repubblica, in Florence, today stands in front of the Art Museum of American University in Washington, D.C. And I don't think it says it on our label upstairs, but you could probably figure out if you concentrate on everything that's going on, who could have gotten permission to put that thing? The first abstract work ever exhibited in the center of Florence, the capital of the Renaissance. Who could have done that? Someone of extraordinary persuasive powers, but only in the Italian language. Quindi pro seclo parlando soltanto in Italian. Therefore, I shall continue in Italian from this moment. At any rate, that came back here. And this is outside. During the label, I forgot to tell you, it's outside the Miami airport, the huge round left. We have a metal for it. And this is about space, and it's not about light. Light is coming. So I show you this example. Half of the works that are in our exhibition upstairs are in this room. And this is an important contemporary art space in Los Angeles, and this exhibition that was done at Mark Bradford's Art and Practice space, an extremely prestigious contemporary space in Los Angeles. Mark Bradford was the artist, let's see, in September, is still the artist who was in the United States Pavilion in the Biennial of Venice. He was chosen. And he chose for his first exhibition in this new space that he's opened to show the artists he likes. Fred Eversley and their own works. And this is how they are displayed, and you see how that works with the idea of minimalism. I showed you those examples with McCracken. And here, unless you are skeptical about my identification of Mark Bradford's gallery of art, that is, you photograph the screen, and this is the press release for the show. This was in the autumn of 16. Now, here's another view of the same installation, and as we saw in the top screen, like a, you know, unfair teacher, I will quiz you even on things you just thought were the introductory screen. You see, he likes the works by, with daylight coming through them and seeing outside. And so they did that because LA, look overhead, LA is filled with light and space and air. And the show was curated by the curator at the Rose Art Museum, who this summer moved to be curator of drawings at the Whitney, Tim Connerty, which was very, very helpful. And Aaron Groft and I, when we went up to Boston, to look in on the Botticelli show, make sure that it had been given all the fanfare we expected for such a great exhibition as that. Brandeis University is in a place called Waltham that you can get to without even Boston. I mean, it was settled near to Boston. And they arranged everything around here, the staircase. And you see there's a circle, a solid, and another circle. That is like a creative license with minimalism on the left-hand side. I love those. That's for me. And this is the other side of the staircase. Okay, so there's a solid, a circle, solid, and the arc that we all know. And at far left, also in the show, there's these two half cylinders that are a model that relate to the Miami Airport sculpture. So we walk around, and you walk around, you look at them by themselves, each piece, each specific object. And Aaron has said, after we were finished, he said, "So what do you think?" And I said, "It's, you know, we needed a protagonist of our African-American display downstairs. We wanted to show off in depth one great artist." And I said, "Great," because I knew we could borrow some additional works. We remember we had the Impressionists from the High Museum of Atlanta. We turned that into Secrets of the Impressionists Color, and so forth. And we all learned a lot, so I said, "Great, let's do it." And this was transformational. This is, I always take photographs of things, and this is about the most interesting shot I could take inside the Brandeis. And what struck me was the beautiful reflections from the windows, because they are all ground to optical, high resolution crater than glass possesses. They aren't optical instruments, friends, because he was always measuring such things. And this gave me an idea. And then when we asked Fred to send us photographs, he and his wife re-photographed them. And instead of the bland look of archival photographs, she's an artist and architect. Look at the way she photographs. I said, "Whoa, how can we do this? How wonderful that is." And because we're working with the artist, we can get his opinion on every stage. You know, we can't, it's not for us to play with. We have this approval along the way. Well into the final galleys, Fred was suggesting changes in the sequence of them. I'll show you. We reached out to him for everything. And his statement here, which we ended up putting in final letters on the exhibition upstairs, I thought, this is what these minimalist installations have not been capturing. The genesis of energy is central to the mystery of our existence as animate beings in an inanimate universe. So simple, but if you think about it, yes, we're in here, hot spots, and everything around us is not alive. And what is it that sets us apart? We have this internal energy. And I realized that he meant what he said, although he never said it specifically. His works contain energy inside them. Well, also influential on him, I like the 60s maps. You can find everything on the internet, except death. And I asked Fred, I sent the map to Fred, and I said, Fred, where did you live, and do live? And so from 63 to 67, he was in that area right on the famous ocean front. That's a circle, on the lower third of it. And, that was the exciting time to be young and running across the street and knowing everybody. And now he's off the garden in the upper right, where he's happy to have a little quite characteristic of Fred. That's why I had to put this in. The map is not that accurate, but good enough. It's extremely precise in all things he does. The light of California is what made the West Coast artists different from the East Coast artists. Simply could not be ignored. The East Coast pieces, which you saw some aluminum squares, steel boxes, I mean, they're like Mark Rothko's studio, low ceiling, and the ashtrays overflowing, and you don't know if there's an outside, let alone what day it is or what's going on. Now, this is an early work by David Korn, but I couldn't resist it because, of course, he's showing us that, you know, water acts as a lens, you know, and so the picture's about nothing else but that reflection. And this is a concern. In 67, he moved into the neighborhood, going to the north. And here are two of the Ocean Park paintings by him. That was where he in the Santa Monica coast, near where he was. So he takes the geometric underpinnings of a mojo, if you will, but adds an atmosphere. It's not smog so much as water laid in muggy LA. That's at least the one on the left. And it's hot on the beach, and sensuous. And this meant something to Fred Emerson also. This one, is not a bad photograph. You're not supposed to be able to see it well. In the center of this, there's an acrylic column. The most famous member of the light and space movement is the still active, very celebrated artist, Robert Irwin. And he started doing things where we see through them and they meld with things. And then he moved on into demarking space with things. And he makes installations, and they were conceptual things walking along a road. He'd leave markers that maybe no one would ever see. But in his mind, this section was different from the next. And these were actually powerful ideas. It influenced a lot of people. And him doing things like this, you know, mean to a young man, 26 years old, decides he wants to be an artist, you know, anything goes. And also, he knows better, James Turrell. James Turrell, this says 92, but I mean, he was doing it back then, opening up the roof, everyone sitting around. I won't go into the details about the refreshments, but they gazed at the sky for long, long periods. Fred recalls it very fondly. And Turrell's hobby at the time is flying. Just past months of his time flying around, pretending he was looking for a spot for an outdoor space. He simply loved it. And he projected things into corners. And look, this is 1960. 1867. It's an illusion. It's not actually there. And he opened up, you know, invisible cracks in the wall in the corner, and you'd think that you could go around it. Quite ingenious. And this is a corner of a room, but you can't see if it's going towards you or to the front of you. It seems to be towards us. And this flattens it out. All of these optical effects. And so what I came to realize was that while past curators have always associated Ted Eversley with the object-making minimalists, and they have exhibited his work in that way, he is the third of a trio with Turrell and Irwin, who tinked light into colors and change our ambient and our experience through that which they do. And this is the piece I know best by him. It's a tunnel, it's the same space, and it goes through every possible variation of that red before starting into the blue and then coming back. And it goes under the street. It is simply the best way to connect two buildings to underground in the world, this wonderful tunnel by Turrell. And the way it is, it's a little intense on our eyes. You're on this walkway, and you can't see how far it is to the floor below. And it's unnerving to figure it out in many, many walks. I've been to the Museum of Fine Arts Houston at least 12 times in the last 10 years to do lectures. So I'm an expert on this thing. And it helped me realize the meaning of Fred Eversley's work. So here we're back to the Los Angeles show of the works. All these works are upstairs currently as we speak. And superb reviews. All the, you know, in a sense, it's a shame. Art in America was reviewed and everything. It's hard to get them back to the same artist within 12 months, but we're working on it. So I thought, instead of doing this, why not show Fred's works with the qualities they possess of having the light within them? Now, could anything express better the light within his works? And here they are, the opening section. They're in their own corner. We have to do things to, we don't have flexible lights. We have state-of-the-art 1983 light. And so we have to do a lot of tricks to make some corners darker than others. And here is this, actually it's a rocker. I'm only telling this group because I know you're responsible. Fred, every time he passes it, takes it off its holder and shows how it rocks. I hate that moment. And there, on the right hand side, you can see the plexiglass stand. That's a nice view here. It's very Dada, these motifs in the background. And what does Dada mean? It means it comes from surrealism. And what is surrealism? Surrealism says dreams are realistic. And so juxtapositions that are surprising have meanings. It's not unreal surrealism, Andre Bertol said. It is a higher realism. So this piece is there. And here it is, an hour show. The way we light it looks like an eclipse. And that, of course, fits a lot of qualities. And why not do this? And this is why Fred said, this is the best installation my work has ever had. You defy you to even find where this motif is. But if you want to have it as your desktop, like, computer, I'm using it currently, it's brilliant. These lenses are lookout stations, and you're supposed to go up, signals you where to go, to look through and see everything transformed. Now, Fred wanted to make a kinetic art without moving parts. The point is, as we move, even the slightest movement by us, the picture inside the lens changes. And that is, to him, you know, moving light is a symbol of energy and of life. It's the opposite of the inertness, the specificity, prized by the minimalism that influenced him towards essential forms and towards geometry, but he wanted to do something with light and energy. And as you can see, rather than saying that art is dead, which Donald Judd said, Fred says, wherever there are humans, there will be art. Thank you. Let's go out and get a little